अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीबॉडी। सो दिस इज पीस मल्टीलैटरलिज्म इन द यूएन। आज वील बी गोइंग ओवर मटेरियल फॉर वीक 13 ऑफ आवर कोर्स एंड वील बी स्पेसिफिकली लुकिंग एट यूएन पीस बिल्डिंग। आई नो वीव बीन टॉकिंग अबाउट पीस कीपिंग एंड अ लिटिल बिट अबाउट पीस बिल्डिंग ऑलरेडी इन दीज लास्ट कपल ऑफ वीक्स। But today we're going to specifically look at UN peace building and discuss certain questions that have come out from the readings that were assigned for this week. So let's go ahead. Now to start with, I just want us to think about two key questions, right? The first one is, what are the possible causes of conflict between and also within states? So we're talking about intra and interstate conflict, right? I know we can come up with like a huge list of possible causes, right? But if we look at one of the readings, I think this was Barnett et al., they've come up with a list of possible causes for conflict, right? Uske andar included kya kya hai? You've got land reform that can potentially spark a conflict, democracy and the rule of law, corruption, gender inequality, refugee crises, economic development or the lack of economic development, ethno-national divisions, ethnic conflict, that's a huge cause of conflict as well, environmental degradation, which can sort of become an indirect or even a direct source of conflict, and transitional justice. So these are just like some causes of conflict that have been listed by the Barnett et al. Reading. What other potential causes of conflict can you think of? Now, the second question I want us to look at is, what conditions or what prerequisites are important or necessary for ensuring sustainable peace in a post-conflict state, right? So we've been talking about sustainable peace for the last couple of weeks. Today, we're going to go into much more detail of what sustainable peace entails and what it means. We might even look at some definitions, and we also will discuss certain concerns that may arise when we bring the idea of sustainable peace to the mainstream, right? But then again, like, let's come back to this question. What conditions or prerequisites do you think are important for us to be able to achieve sustainable peace in areas of conflict? Now, if we start answering this question, the interesting thing is that we'll keep on adding to the list. It's may ek wo infinite list. You can potentially come up with an infinite list, right? So the Goetze and Guzina reading is a very interesting one, and they argue, they propose that in order to build peace, because if we're talking about sustainable peace, we also kind of have to build it from scratch. We need to build states. Yeah, you need to have a functioning state. You need to have a state where there's very little room for possible conflicts. In order to build states, you need to build nations. You need to build a certain sense of identity or a certain sense of belonging to a nation. In order to build nations, you need to build civil societies. You need to build societies that recognize the position of one another as important or as necessary to the building of a nation. In order to build societies, we need to build democracy, right? Because you need to give everybody an equal footing in terms of their voices, in terms of their ability to ask for what they think is necessary for them, and so on and so forth, right? So isme kya ho raha hai ki aap agar if you say for example that having a state is a prerequisite for ensuring sustainable peace, then the question becomes, what are the prerequisites for having a state, right? And then you, according to Goetze and Guzina, you come up with the idea that in order to build states, we need to build nations. But then you ask, theek hai, nations ko build karne ke liye kya kya prerequisites hai? And then you need civil society, theek hai, civil society ko build karne ke liye kya prerequisites hai? Democracy, and so on. So this is going to be a never-ending exercise in one way. And then we'll come back to the idea of that in one of the next few slides. So I've talked about the idea of like a one size fits all approach and how that might not be the best way to ensure peace or to ensure sustainable peace, right? So we know that the sequence of फैक्टर्स लीडिंग टू कॉन्फ्लिक्ट देयर डिफरेंट इन ईच केस, राइट? अभी हमने पिछली स्लाइड में भी जो पहले क्वेश्चन को आंसर किया था, इट्स नॉट नेसेसरी कि हर कॉन्फ्लिक्ट के कॉजेज में कोई इस तरह का एथनिक कॉन्फ्लिक्ट हो. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इट माइट जस्ट बी दैट इट्स द रिजल्ट ऑफ, लेट्स से, द ब्रेक डाउन ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी. सो व्हेन यू से कि द फैक्टर्स लीडिंग टू अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट आर डिफरेंट, देन इट्स ओनली लॉजिकल के पीस बिल्डिंग की कोई एक वन अप्रोच नहीं है जो कि सब एरियाज ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट के ऊपर इक्वली अप्लाई करेगी, राइट? सो वी नो दैट द कॉजेज ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट दे आर मोस्टली मल्टी लेवल रादर देन सिंगुलर. कोई एक डायरेक्ट कॉज यू कैन जस्ट एट्रीब्यूट इट टू वन फैक्टर, राइट? देयर इज ऑलवेज गोइंग टू बी इंटरवीनिंग वेरिएबल्स, इंटरवीनिंग फैक्टर्स और इंस्टेंसेज और केसेज दैट सॉर्ट ऑफ कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू द क्रिएशन ऑफ अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट. एंड दैट अगेन ऑल्सो इम्प्लाइज कि वी कैन नॉट हैव वन approach that fits all conflicts. This also implies that international peace building missions have to address up to a certain level or up to a certain layer of conflict. Is it even possible, then the question becomes, to go to the deepest layer of conflict? First of all, aapko determine karna hai ki cause kya hai conflict ka, right? But then you ask ki theek hai ye, but then you have to like sort of keep going backwards in history, right? So if you keep going backwards and backwards, at what, like, what layer is it where these peace building missions or initiatives that have to stop feeling responsible to address those layers, for example? I mean, you cannot change what's already happened in history, but there might be a lot of contributions or contributors to a certain conflict, and so it becomes slightly difficult to determine ke kitni depth tak jaake aapko address karna hai conflict ko. So that's again a question that I think we can flag for Wednesday's discussion, right? So how far must international organizations, specifically UN, peace building efforts go? And keep in mind ki hamara idea, ki hamara goal kya hai, ki we want to build sustainable peace, not just peace, that's it, but sustainable peace. So remember in one of the first slides, in this slide, we talked about the second question, right? Okay, what preconditions or what prerequisites exist for ensuring sustainable peace? So the answer to that, it sort of boils down to the idea of turtles all the way down. And this was again referred by the Goetz and Guzina reading, where they talk about the idea of turtles all the way down when it comes to peace building and state building, right? State building or peace building, because they use the terms interchangeably, peace building has become the enterprise of turtles all the way down, they argue. When one domain of the construction work is found to be faulty, the main cause for the damages analyzed as being in another domain, right? So that's like one way that they are conceptualizing the idea of peace building in terms of its practicality, in terms of how it's been applied over the course of history, over the course of the UN history. So what's interesting about the idea of turtles all the way down is that when you say that one element of a certain operation or one element of a certain peace building mission, for example, has failed, then you can't just blame that one particular component. You have to sort of analyze what factors in another domain may have contributed to that factor then failing or not succeeding as it had been imagined, right? So if you even look at the diagram, right, it the idea of turtles all the way down, it comes from this hypothetical question, for example, that who's holding up the world, right? So at some point I imagine that there's one turtle that's sort of like, you know, carrying the world on its shell. I imagine that's what we call this part. But then the question becomes, okay, but then who's supporting that turtle, right? So you say, okay, another turtle, but who's supporting that turtle, another one, and you sort of like keep going down to infinity, right? So even at this point, you'd be asking, okay, this turtle ko kaun support kare? So again, like when we ask what could have potentially gone wrong in a peace building mission that did not really succeed, you have to keep going down, you have to keep sort of looking for areas, or you have to keep looking for sources or causes further damage, and the domains that they emerge from. तो basically इसका idea ये है कि अगर कोई failure हुआ भी है तो वो एक domain में completely आप उसको नहीं block out कर सकते, right? There's always going to be some interrelations that also failed between and among other domains of the peace building mission, and that sort of gives a better idea of what worked and what did not work. Then a question, we're going to move on a little bit, and we're going to ask something that we probably should have been asking for the last couple of weeks, right? So what is peace? So we've been talking about peacekeeping, we've been talking about peacemaking a little bit, and peace building, we're talking about peace building now. So we need to have a common idea of peace first, right? So my first question for you is it necessary for us to have a consensus on the definition of peace? For example, how would each of you define peace? Think about it for a few seconds. Right, so I would say at the very basic level, peace is about the absence of war. Like, if you just want to define that, like the surface level, for example, right? It's intuitive. If I say ki peace kya hai, to you'd say it's the absence of war, because peace, agar aap keh rahe ki kahin exist karta hai, to that sort of excludes the idea that there's a war present in that situation. But then we also need to go deeper, right? So we need to ask it, what's the difference then between negative and positive peace, and the differentiation between the two terms, negative peace and positive peace, is also important for us specifically, because it adds nuance to how we perceive peace. Peace is the absence of war, but we need to add nuance to it. We need to make it slightly more complicated so that we understand peace or its dimensions better. So negative peace kya hai? Now negative peace itself jo hai thoda sa ek oxymoron sa lagta hai ki ek taraf se to main keh rahi hu peace, right? So we all sort of aspire for peace, for example. But then I'm calling it negative peace. Negative, again, uski connotation jo hai wo thodi si negative side pe obviously hai. Because the question becomes ki peace hai to peace negative kaise ho sakta, right? But basically, when you say negative peace, you're basically implying absence, right? So Doyle and Sambanis, they also refer to negative peace as sovereign peace. So isko hum in the future slides, there might be some places where I call it sovereign peace. This is more like a lenient definition of peace. And so it's sovereign or negative peace, it requires an end to civil war, undivided sovereignty, no residual violence, and no mass level human rights abuses by the state. So it's a negative standard of peace, which is focusing more on the absence of large scale violence, right? So agar aapne negative peace ko define karna ho, to I think the very important thing to put forward is that negative peace is simply the absence of large scale violence, right? And that violence can be of several forms, right? That violence can be civil war, it can be residual violence from like a previous conflict, it can be human rights abuses, so all these things. But basically negative peace kya hota, it's the absence of large scale violence. And then we come to positive peace. Positive peace ko again unhone Doyle and Sambanis wali reading mein, they've also called it participatory peace. So where on the one hand negative peace, where it looks at the absence of causes of war, it looks at the absence of large scale violence. Positive peace hamare liye important kyun hai, because it looks more towards sustainable peace. It looks at the presence of structures, inke participatory isme keyword aa gaya, so presence of structures or justices that can promote peace. So participatory peace, it requires sovereign peace plus a minimum level of political openness. Now this is another like condition, right? So isse imply kya ho raha hai ki participatory peace ya positive peace tab tak nahi aayega jab tak negative peace nahi hoga, right? So if you don't have negative peace in a certain situation, in a certain area of conflict, if you haven't established negative peace, then positive peace is sort of not attainable. It's not going to be possible. Why? Because that sovereign peace, your negative peace, is a condition, a precondition, a prerequisite. And also you need like a minimum level of political openness, right? So that you structures वगैरह create या फिर promote कर सकें जो कि again peace या sustainable peace को promote करेंगे. So we've discussed negative peace and positive peace, and we know that positive peace is not going to be possible until and unless you have negative peace. पीस बिल्डिंग अगेन उसकी डेफिनेशन को हम थोड़ा सा देखेंगे. इट्स नॉट समथिंग जिसकी एक सिंगुलर सी डेफिनेशन है विच इज़ अग्रीड अपॉन. देयर इज़ नो कंसेंसस ऑन इट्स डेफिनेशन, राइट? सो बेसिकली एक ऐसी टर्म है जो कि डेफिनेशन ले लेती है अकॉर्डिंग टू द सिचुएशन वेयर इट इज़ अप्लाई प्राइमरली. सो बेसिकली 1992 में UN सेक्रेटरी जनरल वाज बूत्रोस गाली एट दैट पॉइंट. दे ही डिफाइंड इट इन नॉट डिफाइंड बट एक्सप्लेन्ड इट इन सर्टेन टर्म्स, राइट? So peace building is any action to identify and support structures which will tend to strengthen and solidify peace in order to avoid relapse into conflict. So isme ki kya aa jata hai baat ke, it's any structure that's put in place that will prevent relapse into conflict, right? Aur jo ke again this is like essentially what you would want for a sustainable peace as well, kya aap relapse na kare. So sustainable peace at the very outset or at its very core presupposes that relapse into conflict is not going to be the case, right? In sustainable peace. A generic si definition jo hai wo isi Barnett et al. Reading mein hai ki external interventions in peace building that are intended to reduce the risk that a state will erupt into or return to war again. Aap isme jo terminology use ho rahi hai wo us par agar focus kare to it's, you know, to prevent relapse, to prevent a return to conflict. In 2000, we talked about the Brahimi report in one of the previous lectures. But Brahimi report can be redefined peace building in some words. And usme it basically said peace building includes activities undertaken on the far side of conflict to reassemble the foundations of peace and provide the tools for building on those foundations, something that is more than just the absence of war. Absence of war, yani ke that is more than just negative peace. सो ब्रहिमी रिपोर्ट जो है वो एक बेसिकली एक तरह से पॉजिटिव पीस या पार्टिसिपेटरी पीस को ही डिफाइन कर रही है. क्यों? क्योंकि वो कह रही है कि इट हैज़ टू बी मोर देन जस्ट एब्सेंस ऑफ वॉर, आई नेगेटिव पीस. एंड इट ऑल्सो इंक्लूड्स एक्टिविटीज टू बिल्ड और टू रीअसेंबल द फाउंडेशन ऑफ पीस एंड ऑल्सो टू प्रोवाइड द टूल्स और द स्ट्रक्चर्स फॉर बिल्डिंग ऑन दोज फाउंडेशन, समथिंग दैट इज़ मोर सस्टेनेबल. सो if you were to compare and contrast the definitions given above, how would you go about it? Are all three definitions the same in your view? Ya phir ek definition hai wo kuch extra add kar rahi hai? And basically how are they different, if they are different at all? Now earlier in the course we also discussed the definition of sustainability. This is I think before the mids perhaps. Now the generally accepted definition of sustainability as provided in the Brundtland report, it was vague, it was very broad. It was broad enough to allow appropriation by different sectors around the world. I don't know if I've discussed this in class, but sustainable environment ke liye use hui thi in the 1987 Brundtland report, right? But then now we see sustainable architecture, we see sustainable packaging, we see sustainable fashion and all these things. In some cases, the appropriation might be warranted, but in other cases, it might just become a marketing gimmick. So that's again something that one has to be careful or wary of. Now, peace building's definition, it also, I think, runs a similar risk or an opportunity even. Because sustainability, if we say appropriate, it's also been like a good opportunity to appropriate that approach or that idea or ideal. Now peace building ke case mein groups and or global actors, they can appropriate the term peace building for their own version of peace building. This can be both good and bad. It can be a risk bhi ho sakti hai, opportunity bhi ho sakti hai. Risk kyun ho sakti hai? Kyunki aap maybe not so peaceful actions ko aap disguise kar rahe ho in a certain definition of peace building, right? So you might not actually be going ahead and building peace, but you'll be claiming that you are, and that's not very useful, right? But opportunity kis tarah se ho sakti hai ke you can figure out ways to contribute to the idea of peace building. You can figure out ways to build structures, for example, that will promote sustainable peace. Barnett et al., they argue that we need to be very aware of the particular version of peace building that is being institutionalized. Right? So this is, again, a very important thing to consider. कि जो इंस्टीट्यूशनलाइज हो रहा है पीस बिल्डिंग का आइडिया या फिर उसका वर्जन वो कौन से वाला है, राइट? सो इट्स ऑलवेज, दैट्स व्हाई आई वेंट ओवर दीज डिफरेंट डेफिनेशंस, क्योंकि ऑब्वियसली लाइक इफ यू डिफाइनिंग इट, लेट्स से, बट वील कम बैक टू इट एक्चुअली ऑन आवर डिस्कशन सेशन ऑन वेंसडे. यस, सो थिंक अबाउट दिस. नाउ अनदर क्वेश्चन आई हैव फॉर यू इज, व्हाट आर द पोटेंशियल बेनिफिट्स एंड और डेंजर्स ऑफ द अप्रोप्रिएशन ऑफ पीस बिल्डिंग बाई डिफरेंट सेक्टर्स? तो थिंक अबाउट इट. इसको थोड़ा सा अगर आपने करना है कंपेयर एंड कॉन्ट्रास्ट, यू कैन गो बैक टू आइडिया ऑफ सस्टेनेबिलिटी और वो किस तरह से अप्रोप्रिएट हुआ एंड वेदर और नॉट इट्स बीन यूजफुल और नॉट, एंड कम अप विद एन आइडिया कि पीस बिल्डिंग अगर अप्रोप्रिएट हो डिफरेंट सेक्टर्स से तो उसके बेनिफिट्स क्या हो सकते हैं और उसके डेंजर्स क्या हो सकते हैं. नाउ गोइंग फर्दर, पीस बिल्डिंग की फोर कैटेगरीज हम डिस्कस कर सकते हैं एज सजेस्टेड बाय बार्नेट एट ऑल. एक हो गया सिक्योरिटी एंड मिलिटरी, राइट? सो दैट्स अगेन सेल्फ एक्सप्लेनेटरी आई थिंक, इन्वॉल्व्स मिलिटरी इंटरवेंशन एंड ऑल दैट, जो पीस कीपिंग, पीस बिल्डिंग फोर्सेस, पीस मिशंस एंड व्हाट नॉट. द सेकेंड इज सोशल इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंटल एंड ह्यूमैनिटेरियन पीस बिल्डिंग, राइट? सो जो पहला वाला है इट्स मोर रिलेटेड टू आई थिंक द आइडिया ऑफ नेगेटिव पीस. And then all of these, they relate more to the idea of positive peace, as we've discussed it in previous slides. So second wale mein kya hai, social, economic, developmental and humanitarian. So you building structures, you building institutions, ek tarah se, jo ke sustainable peace ko promote karenge. Political and diplomatic, it again, you're rebuilding, let's say, the state, you're rebuilding the nation and you're rebuilding a society, ek tarah se. And then finally kya hai, justice and reconciliation, wo bhi ek category hai, which again is more towards building some more sustainable peace. Again, wo phir positive ya participatory peace ki taraf aa jata hai. Then post conflict peace building. How is post conflict different peace building different from peace building in general? Kya peace building sirf एक ऐसे एरिया में ही होती है जहाँ पर कॉन्फ्लिक्ट होके ख़त्म हुआ हो, या इफ़ वी टॉकिंग अबाउट प्रिवेंटिव डिप्लोमेसी, तो जिन एरियाज में प्रिवेंटिव डिप्लोमेसी अप्लाई होती है, विच मीन्स के कॉन्फ्लिक्ट जो है वो फुल फ्लेज्ड कॉन्फ्लिक्ट नहीं बना, तो इज़ पीस बिल्डिंग ऑल्सो रेलिवेंट देयर? व्हाट डू यू थिंक? आई एम स्टारिंग दिस सो वी कैन रिमेंबर कि हमने वेंसडे को डिस्कस करना है. नाउ बार्नेट एट अल, अगेन दे आइडेंटिफाई थ्री डायमेंशंस ऑफ पोस्ट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट पीस बिल्डिंग, right? एक हो गया स्टेबिलिटी क्रिएशन, विच मेक सेंस कि यू वॉन्ट टू बी एबल टू मेक श्योर दैट द स्टेट दैट यू आर इंटरवीनिंग इन इज स्टेबल सो दैट इट डजंट रिलैप्स इनटू वॉर और कॉन्फ्लिक्ट अगेन. सेकेंड इज रिस्टोरेशन ऑफ स्टेट इंस्टीट्यूशन, रिस्टोरेशन और इवन फाउंडेशंस ऑफ, यू नो, बिकॉज मे बी स्टेट इंस्टीट्यूशन एग्जिस्ट करते ही नहीं थे, दैट्स वाई द कॉन्फ्लिक्ट केम टू बी. थर्ड क्या है, एड्रेसिंग द सोशियो इकोनॉमिक डायमेंशंस ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट. सो दिस इज मोर ऑफ अ होलिस्टिक अप्रोच, और थ्री डायमेंशंस दैट वुड पोटेंशियली इन्फॉर्म अ मोर होलिस्टिक अप्रोच टू पोस्ट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट पीस बिल्डिंग. अब ये तीन डायमेंशंस क्या अज्यूम करिए कि जो कॉन्फ्लिक्ट अराइज हुआ था उसमें तीन की फैक्टर्स जो थे वो यही थे कि इंस्टेबिलिटी हो गई थी, स्टेट इंस्टीट्यूशंस वर नॉट फंक्शनिंग एट द ऑप्टिमल लेवल्स, एंड देयर वर लाइक सोशियो इकोनॉमिक अंडरपिनिंग्स टू द कॉन्फ्लिक्ट. बट जो हमने पहली स्लाइड में जिसमें वो दो क्वेश्चंस थे, वी डिस्कस द पॉसिबल कॉजेज ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट, राइट? एंड वी रियलाइज के उसमें और भी काफ़ी सारी चीज़ें हैं, देर कैन बी एन एथनिक डायमेंशन टू इट. तो ये तीन डायमेंशन जो है पोस्ट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट पीस बिल्डिंग की, ये उन सबको आई डोंट थिंक रिकग्नाइज कर रही हैं. बट देन अगेन, इफ़ यू कीप एडिंग डायमेंशंस टू इट, देन इसकी यूटिलिटी माइट जस्ट कम इन टू क्वेश्चन. बट आई डोंट नो, आई थिंक इट शुड हैव अकाउंटेड फॉर मेनी मोर different dimensions or different causes or factors leading to conflict in the first place. We can however, argue के post conflict peace building जो है it looks at both positive and negative peace. Stability creation sort of points us towards negative peace creating, peace building. और points 2 and 3 हैं इस list में जो they point us towards more positive peace building approaches. अगेन थोड़ा सा और हमने अप्रोप्रिएशन की बात की थी पिछली एक स्लाइड में, तो दिस इज़ जस्ट सम इंटरेस्टिंग एक्सर्प्ट फ्रॉम हार्ट नेक्री बुक, आई थिंक इट्स कॉल्ड एम्पायर, जो कि गुडसन गुजीना वाली रीडिंग में उन्होंने साइट की है. सो देर सेइंग के हार्ट एंड नेक्री इन देयर बुक दे आर्ग्यू दैट द यूएन इज़ मटीरियली ऑर्गेनाइज्ड एज एन अपैरेटस ऑफ एम्पायर rather than ordering the world and developing an international law in its own right, the UN is reifying, universalizing and hence legitimizing an existing law of policing and control that has been created in domestic politics by powerful states, notably those of the Security Council, and that is extrapolated to the world in order to regulate peripheral zones of the globe, right? So there is a dependency theory can be basically, and it's also basically essentially arguing ke the UN has used its form or its position to universalize and also legitimize, right? So universalize and legitimize and also reify the existing law of control, which has essentially been created or initiated by powerful states, particularly the P5. So that's essentially what this excerpt is going for. So basically appropriation ka aap is tarah se bhi keh sakte hain ki it's peace building, you could argue, is a term that has been appropriated by the P5 to sort of legitimize their actions in different contexts. And also like going further with definition, right? There's also ambiguity in definitions because abhi tak I think we've looked at least 5 or 6 ways that peace building has been defined. And so ambiguity kya hogi ke matlab basically not all of them use the same terms, not all of them possibly agree on all of their dimensions and all that. So iska pro kya hai, it's a favored political symbol. Ambiguity can facilitate collective action because different constituencies can support the symbol without necessarily achieving consensus on the substance, right? So agar consensus nahi hai because you don't have like a singularly defined singularly agreed upon definition, iska matlab hai ki collective action kyun facilitate hoga, because different groups or different constituencies they can support the symbol without really needing ke consensus ho is pe. Pro ek hi hai. Kaun kya hai isme और द ड्रॉबैक्स, पहला है कि द प्रॉब्लम ऑफ कोऑर्डिनेशन व्हेन मैंडेट्स ओवरलैप और व्हेन द डेफिनेशंस यूज्ड बाय डिफरेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस आर नॉट ऑन द सेम पेज, राइट? सो कोऑर्डिनेशन प्रॉब्लम मेन आ गया बिकॉज ऑफ द डेफिनेशंस बीइंग वेरी वेग और ब्रॉड और जस्ट एम्बिगुअस, सो कोऑर्डिनेशन बिकम्स लाइक अ डिफिकल्ट थिंग टू अचीव. And also एक और सेकेंड कॉन क्या है कि when the Bush administration thinks of peace building, it imagines building market-oriented democracies, right? Because they're coming from like a US-centric view. हमने ethnocentrism की I think बात की हुई है, so जो सेकेंड कॉन है वो बेसिकली ethnocentrism का ही एक इशू बता रहा है. So what are they saying? कि when the Bush administration thinks of peace building, it imagines building market-oriented democracies, while the UNDP imagines creating economic development and strong civil societies committed to a culture of non-violent dispute resolution. So essentially kya hai ke iske andar there's a difference between how peace building is envisioned, right? Again wo ek ambiguity hai definitions mein. So the Bush administration or the US government would view peace building in a different way compared with, let's say, the UNDP. And then again, whose definition gets prioritized, gets or jo cheez prioritize hogi definitions ke hisab se, that's going to decide a lot of the outcomes in the global political scenario. So ek peace building ki case study I wanted to go over today was the the UN TAG, or what they also call UNTAG mission in Namibia. This was not a very long presence. I think in Nakash's presentation, where we discussed that average year jo hai UN intervention ka, it can go as far as like 25 years or so, but this was a very short stay. So this was from April 1989 to March 1990. Military peacekeeping and logistics ki forces, this is just numbers, kyunki presence kitni heavy thi ek tarah se. So peacekeeping forces and logistics related forces, they included 4,493 members. Police monitors the inke paas 1,500. Electoral supervisors the 885. Or staff the 458. So this is less than 10,000 people jo ki UN ke presence form kar rahe the. Now the UNTAC iska essentially kya tha, it was a transition assistance program. Functions iske again night wali reading ke andar define hue hai, but I'll just quickly go over them. Demilitarization of the country, supervising and controlling the activities of the South African Administrator General and territorial bureaucracy during the transition. Again, it was like supervising and controlling things during the transition process, including the repeal of repressive statutes and release of political prisoners. So थोड़ा सा जस्टिस की तरफ आ गया, जो हमने तीन डायमेंशंस पहले डिस्कस की थी. मेंटेनेंस ऑफ लॉ एंड ऑर्डर, वोटर रजिस्ट्रेशन, अगेन क्योंकि उसमें इलेक्टोरल कंपोनेंट भी था. अरेंजमेंट्स फॉर द पोलिंग इटसेल्फ एंड द ड्राफ्टिंग ऑफ इलेक्टोरल लॉज फॉर द कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली इलेक्शंस, सर्टिफिकेशन ऑफ द इलेक्शन रिजल्ट्स एज टू वेदर दे वर फ्री एंड फेयर, इन कोऑर्डिनेटिंग विद प्रिटोरिया एंड द कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली अरेंजमेंट्स फॉर इंडिपेंडेंस. राइट, सो दिस इज बेसिकली लाइक अ ट्रांजिशन फोर्स जहाँ पर वो they were becoming independent. So UN ka kaam kya tha, to make sure ki everything goes smoothly. Now South Africa, it would not really have voluntarily agreed to a transition plan, right, for Namibia, led by what South Africa perceived as a biased and hostile United Nations that had it not retained administrative responsibility for the territory. Right, so again, things had to be worked out given the context of the situation. Again, jo humne baat shuru mein ki thi ki one size fits all approach does not work when it comes to peace building or peacekeeping. So this is a good example of why or how. Now, one reason for the supposed success of the UNTAG mission, it can be attributed to the money that was spent. Right, so almost you 416 million US dollars. It's what the night reading calls it Cadillac class operation, which is apparently like an expensive car, I suppose. And there was ample room also for spending on information and propaganda. Right? So basically it was like an expensive peace building mission. Context, which meant ke international level scrutiny bhi thi is program ke upar. And linkages, they also matter for ensuring success. So context and linkages matter for ensuring success of a peace building mission such as the UNTAG mission in Namibia. The Namibian question, it had consistently loomed large in UN deliberations since its inception. So Namibian jo basically case tha, it wasn't something that was new jo ke 1989 mein aake ekdam se UN ko action lena pada, but it was something that had been looming large around the UN, similar to I think how the Kashmir issue has been looming large, but not much has been done in that regard. The Namibian issue, it was ultimately linked to the international campaign against apartheid in South Africa. Now in one of the classes we discussed the timeline of how long it took the UN to take action against the apartheid, right? I think this was again before the midterms. So but eventually kya hua tha, towards the end of the apartheid period, there was so much international scrutiny or just so much international campaign against the apartheid, ke when the Namibian issue got linked to that situation, the UN was more compelled to act within Namibia, right? So again, context aapne dekhna hai ki international level par kya context chal raha hai, political ya economic, and that can sometimes drive the UN to take certain actions. Namibia ke success factors kya the? I'm sure you'll probably like get more through the reading. But essentially kya tha ke the disposition of major global powers, jaise maine bhi discuss kiya hai ki, you know, apartheid was like a major point at major event at that point, was per scrutiny itni zyada thi ke the global powers, they were leaning towards, you know, action as opposed to inaction. The disposition of key regional actors within or around Namibia, again aap isme kehte humne shuru mein jo discuss kiya tha ke in order to keep or to build peace, there must be like peace, there must be a will for it, right? So basically will jo hai wo exist karti thi, and that's also what point number 3 says. And also finally the credibility and effectiveness of the transitional operation itself, right? Usme uske functions I think are clearly defined, as we've seen in like the one of the previous slides. The presence was strong, so you had like around 4,000 ish peacekeeping forces, but then again it wasn't an overwhelming amount, I would say. And also because the functions were clear, so credibility bhi guarantee ek tarah se ho gayi thi. Now next we're going to look at peace building, but is it a good thing or is it a bad thing, right? We read a lot about it in this week's readings. But the question again becomes, ke, is peace building a useful tool? Is it a good tool or is it a bad tool? Krasner and Kaplan, they hold an extreme view about, this is basically something that the Goetz and Kuzina reading goes through. So they go over the research work done by Krasner and Kaplan, and they conclude that they hold an extreme view about the level of intervention required for peace building initiatives. Krasner pleads for an authoritarian extension of direct rule over troubled territories, jiska matlab hai ke total agar UNTAG mein, UN tag mein, Namibia mein, Krasner would have wanted ke the military force should take over completely, right? While Kaplan would argue ye ek side ki extreme aagi. Kaplan on the other hand argues that one can justify a partial or complete suspension of sovereignty, at least temporarily. Right, so these are extreme views essentially. The question is, can institutions be built from scratch? Because jo humne positive peace ki baat ki thi usme aksar ye bhi kaha gaya ki foundations lay down ki jaye jo ke phir aage jaake peace ko promote kare ya phir sustainable peace ko develop kar sake. But the question is, is it even possible to build institutions from scratch? अगर हम कह रहे हैं कि हमने इस्टेब्लिश करने, वेर एज द ट्रांजिशन पैराडाइम जो कि बेसिकली यू नो द यूएन टैग इज एन एग्जांपल, रिलाइज ऑन द आइडिया दैट इंस्टीट्यूशंस कैन बी क्रिएटेड फ्रॉम स्क्रैच. सम स्कॉलर्स दे हैव क्वेश्चन्ड वेदर और नॉट हिस्टोरिकल लेगेसीज ऑफ प्रीसीडिंग इकोनॉमिक, सोशल एंड इंस्टीट्यूशनल कंडीशंस कुड हैव अ मच ग्रेटर इम्पैक्ट ऑन द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी. तो ये एक तरह से पार्ट डिपेंडेंसी की आर्ग्यूमेंट आ गई, राइट? बेसिकली आई थिंक वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स एज वेल कि पार्ट डिपेंडेंसी इज़ अ वेरी रियल थिंग, विच मीन्स कि इंस्टीट्यूशंस कैन नॉट ऑलवेज जस्ट बी बिल्ड फ्रॉम स्क्रैच, क्योंकि हिस्टोरिकली या हिस्टोरिकल लेगेसीज जो हैं एक जगह की, दे डू इन्फॉर्म टू अ वेरी लार्ज एक्सटेंट के इंस्टीट्यूशंस एग्जिस्ट जो करते हैं वो कितने स्ट्रॉन्ग हैं, कितने स्टिकी हैं, एंड हाउ और टू वॉट एक्सटेंट कैन वी ओवरहॉल देम कम्प्लीटली. फिर प्रोपोनेंट में पहले दो स्लाइड्स में जो हैं क्रिटिक्स के कैंप्स देखे, राइट, वेयर दे आर ईदर लाइक होल्डिंग एक्सट्रीम व्यूज़ के नहीं फुल इंटरवेंशन होनी चाहिए, यू नो द यूएन शुड यूज़ एन अथॉरिटेटिव स्टैंस, अथॉरिटेरियन स्टैंस एंड कम्प्लीटली टेक ओवर एज अपोज टू यू नो मेकिंग एफर्ट्स टू बिल्ड पीस. फिर प्रोपोनेंट्स क्या कहते हैं कि पीपल हु आर्ग्यू दैट पीस बिल्डिंग इज़ गुड, व्हाट डू दे से? These authors, they see the UN as a legitimate balancing power to the US, first of all, and they do not question in principle the idea that the triad of democracy, the market economy and civil society is the only viable way out of conflict and misery, right? So basically, they think the UN is important because it balances the power of the US or checks the power of the US, And the triad of democracy, market economy and civil society, they agree, is the only viable way out of conflict and misery. Basically, वो क्या argue कर रहे हैं कि positive peace build करने के लिए आपको आपके पास democracy भी होनी चाहिए, आपकी market economy होनी चाहिए, and you should have a strong civil society. And that's the only way that you can build positive peace, essentially, is what they're arguing. So ये दूसरा camp आ गया. फिर question आता है कि how do we know कि जी अब peace building जो है वो successful हो गया. Essentially, when is peace building successful? Doyle and Sambani's, they conducted an interesting quantitative study, जो कि I would recommend that you definitely should go through it in detail. They basically measured the degree to which various factors can predict the success or failure of peace building initiatives. उन्होंने basically peace building success को correlate करने की कोशिश की with ethnic wars, with the human cost of war, with the duration of war, with the presence of factions, with the presence or absence of treaties, and also the timing of intervention. Remember, हमने पिछले कुछ lectures में discuss किया कि timing of intervention matters a lot as well. So they've done a study on that. तो पहला उन्होंने factor क्या discuss study किया है, ethnic conflicts or ethnic wars and peace building. Now they came to the conclusion that the probability of peace building success, it should be lower after ethnic or religious wars, because the indicator of ethno-religious wars was highly significant and negatively correlated with peace building success in most specifications that they tried, although it did seem less significant for sovereign peace than for participatory peace. Again, उन्होंने negative peace or positive peace के हिसाब से भी देखा. Now what does this mean? इस ग्राफ में आपको क्या पता चल रहा है? राइट, सो अगर कोई एथनिक वॉर हुई थी, नाउ वी गोइंग टू लुक एट दिस वन फर्स्ट. द वाई एक्सिस इट शोज द प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेस, और एक्स एक्सिस के ऊपर आ रहे लॉग ऑफ डेथ्स एंड डिस्प्लेसमेंट्स. राइट, सो जितनी ज़्यादा डेथ्स एंड डिस्प्लेसमेंट्स हो रही हैं फॉर एन एथनिक वॉर, उतनी प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेस डिक्रीज हो रही है. सो बेसिकली क्या हो रहा है कि जितनी ज़्यादा कैजुअलिटीज़ हो रही हैं इन एन एथनिक वॉर, उतना कम पीस बिल्डिंग का सक्सेस होगा. नाउ अगर एथनिक वॉर नहीं भी होगी तो भी प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ सक्सेस जो है वो कम होती जा रही है एज द कैजुअलिटीज़ इंक्रीज. बट the margin is somewhat different, right? So again, let's go back to the explanation. They concluded that their indicator of ethno-religious wars is highly significant and negatively correlated with peace building success. So jitni zyada badi war, jitni intensive ethno-religious war hogi, utna kam peace building success hoga, right? And it's more significant for participatory or positive peace. So again, इसमें थोड़ा सा sustainable peace की तरफ आ जाएगा कि जितनी intensive या जितनी high casualties होंगी in an ethno-religious war, उतना peace building या sustainable peace building कम successful होगा. Second आ जाते हैं factions, वो peace building के साथ correlate करना. Again, Doyle and Sambani, they found that the number of factions is significant and negatively associated with peace building. So the number of factions is a key indicator here. Again, इसमें क्या आ रहा है कि x axis के ऊपर आपके इस्तीफा आ गए हैं number of factions, और y axis पर probability of peace building success. जितने ज़्यादा factions हो रहे हैं उतने कम आपका peace building success हो रहा है. And they've done it for high local capacities and also for low local capacities. दोनों cases में graphs are more or less the same. जितने ज़्यादा फैक्शंस हो गए विद इन अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट, यानी जितनी ज़्यादा पार्टीज टू कॉन्फ्लिक्ट होंगी, उतना मुश्किल होगा पीस बिल्डिंग को सक्सेसफुल होना. फिर आ जाता है ह्यूमन कॉस्ट ऑफ वॉर एंड पीस बिल्डिंग. उनकी एक्सपेक्टेशन क्या थी कि प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेस इट शुड बी लोअर द ग्रेटर द ह्यूमन कॉस्ट ऑफ द वॉर, एज इनके जितनी ज़्यादा कैजुअलिटीज़ वगैरह होंगी उतना पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेस कम होगा. क्यों? क्योंकि पोस्ट वॉर लेवल्स ऑफ हॉस्टेलिटी इंक्रीज होंगे. नाउ दिस इज़ अ वेरी की थिंग टू कंसिडर, राइट? क्योंकि वन वी टॉकिंग अबाउट पीस बिल्डिंग, यू ऑल्सो हैव टू सॉर्ट ऑफ मेजर सम हाउ कि कॉन्टेक्स्ट क्या है इन इन एरिया ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट, राइट? उसमें हॉस्टेलिटी लेवल्स कितने ज़्यादा हैं, और इन्होंने क्या एक्सपेक्ट किया था कि जितनी ज़्यादा ह्यूमन कॉस्ट ऑफ वॉर होगी उतने ज़्यादा पोस्ट वॉर या पोस्ट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट लेवल्स ऑफ हॉस्टेलिटी होंगे, विच मीन्स अगेन कि पीस बिल्डिंग के सक्सेसफुल होने का कम चांसेस होंगे, राइट? व्हाट डिड दे फाइंड? दे फाउंड दैट द ह्यूमन मिजरी क्रिएटेड बाय वॉर इज़ नेगेटिवली एंड सिग्निफिकेंटली एसोसिएटेड विद पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेस. जितनी ज़्यादा ह्यूमन मिजरी या जितनी ज़्यादा लेवल्स ऑफ हॉस्टेलिटी होंगे आफ्टर अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट उतना कम पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेस होगा. But this result it does not hold as well with respect to the total deaths alone without accounting for displacements. Remember when I earlier said that post-war levels of human cost of war mein kya hai? It's not just deaths or casualties, it's also for displacements. Right? So jo inka result aaya hai ye wala ki ye significant association hai, uske andar significance tab aa rahi hai jab they're including total deaths as well as displacements. So that's also important to consider. फिर आ जाता है ट्रीटीज़. उनका हाइपोथेसिस क्या था कि ट्रीटीज़ जो हैं दे शुड बी पॉजिटिवली कोरिलेटेड विद पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेस एंड दे कैन नॉट बी रिजेक्टेड फॉर द दिस हाइपोथेसिस इट कैन नॉट बी रिजेक्टेड फॉर पॉजिटिव पीस बट इट इज़ नॉट एज कन्विंसिंग व्हेन इट कम्स टू नेगेटिव पीस. इसका क्या मतलब है कि उन्होंने हाइपोथेसाइज किया था कि ट्रीटीज़ अगर साइन होंगी तो पीस बिल्डिंग सक्सेसफुल होगा, राइट? दे वर नॉट कन्विंस्ड विद दिस हाइपोथेसिस फॉर नेगेटिव पीस बट दे वर कन्विंस्ड अबाउट दिस हाइपोथेसिस फॉर पॉजिटिव और पार्टिसिपेटरी पीस, राइट? कि अगर आपने ट्रीटीज़ वगैरह साइन की हैं तो देर इज़ अ लार्जर चांस फॉर यू टू हैव मोर सस्टेनेबल और लॉन्ग लास्टिंग पीस. बट अगर ट्रीटीज़ वगैरह साइन हो रही हैं इट डज़ नॉट गारंटी to a convincing level के absence of large scale violence create हो जाएगा. इनकी explanation क्या है? They are arguing that treaties alone seem unable to stop war recurrence but if the violence stops countries that have signed a treaty they are more likely to develop the basis for political participation. basically treaties का क्या है कि treaties become useful once negative peace has been established. और ट्रीटीज़ जो हैं वो नेगेटिव पीस को इस्टेब्लिश करने में नहीं हेल्प करेंगी बट अगर नेगेटिव पीस इस्टेब्लिश हो गया जिसका मतलब है कि वायलेंस वगैरह ख़त्म हो गई है फिर अगर ट्रीटीज़ वगैरह होंगी तो दे आर गोइंग टू हेल्प बिल्ड पॉजिटिव पीस एंड देन पीस बिल्डिंग विल बी अ सक्सेसफुल मिशन. फिर हमने बात करनी थी टाइमिंग ऑफ द इंटरवेंशन, जिस हमने पहले भी डिस्कस किया हुआ है कि एट वॉट पॉइंट should the UN intervene basically. Now the effects of the UN missions they are felt beyond the initial 2 year period but they are stronger in the early post-war phase. Peace interventions they must happen quickly if they are to be successful. उन्होंने क्या basic finding उनकी आई कि peace interventions जो कि पीस कीपिंग या पीस बिल्डिंग भी हो सके they have to happen quickly. Right? If you want success you have to act quickly or you have to intervene quickly. If you are the UN. And that's basically what they found. Now this is a finally before we finish. I just had a possible question that you might want to work on for your response paper. I want you to discuss this point from Doyle and Sambani's reading. Which basically argues that sovereign peace is a prerequisite for participatory peace. आज हमने काफ़ी हद तक डिस्कस किया भी है इस चीज़ को कि नेगेटिव पीस जो है या सॉवरन पीस इज़ अ prerequisite फॉर पॉजिटिव और पार्टिसिपेटरी पीस. डू यू अग्री? डू यू डिसएग्री? व्हाट आर योर थॉट्स ऑन दिस? कैन यू साइट सम एग्जांपल्स ऑफ यू एंड पीस बिल्डिंग मिशंस टू सॉर्ट ऑफ सपोर्ट योर आंसर? बट डू थिंक अबाउट दिस, क्या नेगेटिव पीस होना ज़रूरी है पॉजिटिव पीस के लिए और क्या पॉजिटिव पीस के बगैर नेगेटिव पीस अचीवेबल है या नहीं? सो मेक श्योर दैट यू थिंक अबाउट दिस एंड आई वुड स्ट्रांगली इनकरेज कि आप लोग इसके ऊपर अपना रिस्पॉन्स पेपर लिखने की कोशिश करें. सो दैट वॉज़ इट फॉर टुडे. and we'll meet on Wednesday. Thank you.